I had an interesting experience while attending grad school recently. The subject was ethical leadership, and the class was majority female at 63% women compared to 36% men. I never perceived ethics as a gendered issue, but I thought I would share this interesting lesson on ethical leadership, and the unexpected bonus lesson I learned about male and female nature. The lecture was called Defining Moments by Joseph L. Badaracco of the Harvard Business School. I would include clips from the lecture, but the video is copyrighted and behind a paywall, so I will paraphrase the lecture instead. The lecture begins by separating the difference between choices between right and wrong and choices between right and right. While the choices between right and wrong are fairly easy and the answer is fairly obvious, what do you do when the choice isn't between right and wrong but two rights? Because this was a lecture about business ethics, the example used was the following. Imagine that you're an executive within a company, and you're close friends with one of the managers. He comes into your office and tells you that he's found his dream house, and that even though he had to dip into his son's college fund, he just wanted to tell you how excited he was. Now, while he's talking about this, you know that layoffs are coming to the company, and your friend's name is on the list. As a corporate officer, you have a duty to the company not to mention the layoffs to your friend. However, as a friend, you have a responsibility to help him avoid a serious financial mistake. And you also have a duty to tell the truth. This isn't a dilemma of right versus wrong, but right versus right. The choices between two rights, between the competing responsibilities of two groups, are the hard questions. These are the questions that get your hands dirty and define you not only as a leader, but as a human being. The lecture provides four questions to understand and evaluate these right versus right questions and to make an ethical decision. The first question is to ask which outcome will benefit the largest amount of people. This is called the utilitarian approach and originated in the 1800s from John Stuart Mill. The limitation to this approach can best be demonstrated by presenting the following scenario. Is it ethical to murder someone in order to harvest their organs in order to save five people? If you simply use the utilitarian approach, the answer would be yes, because one person dies in order to save the lives of five. But that would be violating the rights of the person being murdered. The second question is whether or not the rights of the individuals or groups are being respected. This is known as the rights approach. The origins of the rights approach can be found in several foundational documents, such as the American Declaration of Independence. Now, if we've determined that the most people benefit from option A, and that nobody's rights are being violated, that seems like the obvious solution, but we still have two more questions. So let me explain the necessity of the latter two questions with a story taken from the lecture, which was itself taken from a book called The Magus, involving the mayor of an occupied Greek village during World War II. In this village, some children found a gun and killed some of the occupying soldiers, but they were not caught. The Nazis rounded up 100 or so women and children, picked two random children, and declared that these random children were guilty of shooting the soldiers, and instructed the mayor to either kill these two innocent children, or he would instruct his soldiers to shoot into the crowd. Now, in this scenario, the utilitarian approach would lead you, if you were the mayor, to kill the two children in order to save the 100 women and children. The rights approach would not affect this choice because both options would lead to the same violation of rights for either the two children or to the 100 women and children. In the account, the mayor took a rifle, aimed it at the children, pulled the trigger, but heard a click because the rifle had no ammunition. The Nazi commander then instructed the mayor that he would have to beat the children to death with the rifle. This changed everything. Whereas the mayor would have been willing to painlessly shoot these innocent children in order to save 100 innocent lives, he was not willing to brutally beat these children to death. This line that the mayor could not bring himself to cross has been described more or less as sinking down to their level, becoming an animal, etc. So the third question is about character and goes back to Aristotle. Aristotle's answer to what was a quote-unquote good decision was a decision made by a person with a good character. The third question is about what I want to stand for. What will the decision say about me and my character? If history records this moment, what will people say about me? These are the moments that define a person long after they're gone. It's not about consequences or rights, but what a person stands for. The fourth question is simply, what will work in the world as it is? This question comes from Machiavelli. He wasn't saying to take the easy way out or to play to the lowest common denominator, but to do what would work once all available resources have been brought to bear. This is known as the pragmatic approach. So to review, there are four questions. one focused on consequences, one on rights, one on character, and one on pragmatism. The important thing is to take all these questions as a unified system and not simply pick your favorites and ignore the ones you don't like. If you're too dedicated to the utilitarian approach and focus on consequences, you'll end up stomping all over people's rights. If you're too dedicated to the rights approach, you'll end up doing nothing, especially in today's society, where more and more rights and labels of victimhood are created every day. If you're too dedicated to your character over the consequences and the rights of others, you'll be seen as a selfish elitist. King Louis XVI wasn't beheaded during the French Revolution because of a lack of integrity. His example shows that ignoring consequences and the rights of others can have disastrous effects. If you're too dedicated to the pragmatic approach, you will easily be led to abandon any and all morals and ethics and go down the road of corruption and ruin. At the end of the lecture, Joseph L. Badaracco returns to the question of the executive and his friend buying the dream house. He states that what he and other industry leaders that he had talked to about this would do is to find a way to do the right thing by bending the rules a little. They wouldn't alert their friend about the layoffs directly, as that would violate their obligations to the company, but they would say something, perhaps disguising it a bit, while sending a clear message. This is where things got interesting for me personally during the class. As a reminder, my class is mostly women, and all the women in the class agreed that they would not say anything to their friend, because they would not risk their position. When confronted about what they would do once he bought the home and was subsequently laid off and confronted them about why he wasn't warned, the most vocal of the females blamed the friend by saying, quote, "If he was really my friend, he wouldn't have put me in that position," unquote. So not only would they have done nothing to help their so-called friend, but they would blame them after the fact and make themselves out to be the victim for being put into a position where their ethics would have to be put to the test. Meanwhile, all the men in the class, including myself, agreed that we would help the friend without violating our other duties through an internal compromise, which again is in harmony with the lecture itself. Prior to this, I had never thought of ethical leadership as a masculine trait. I was aware that women prefer male bosses even more than men do, but I had previously assumed that this was because women could manipulate male bosses easier than female bosses, but now I believe it's more than that. I believe that based on my observations that women are incapable of ethical leadership due to their selfish natures. Not only did these women make the statement that they would do nothing to help their friend, even after just viewing the lecture and being told the answer, but they even admitted that their motive was that they would not jeopardize their position personally. They didn't care about consequences, rights, integrity, or even pragmatism. They were only interested in what benefited them. Even when they acted out of blatant self-interest, they would assert their own victimhood and blame the people they chose to do nothing to help. I'm not even convinced that the gender of the friend was an issue, but it would be interesting if I could go back and ask the female students if they would help the friend if it was a woman. This experience has led me to believe, barring any new information, that ethical leadership is a male characteristic. Women make terrible leaders, not because they were called bossy as a child or because of traditional gender roles, but because women are inherently selfish and thus incapable of ethical leadership. Put into a position wherein the leader has responsibilities to multiple parties, women would only seek their own interest, while men seem much more capable, indeed perhaps solely capable, of balancing these responsibilities and seeking the most ethical solutions possible. So that's my theory, but I'm interested in knowing if you've experienced the same things when dealing with women in leadership roles. Have you had a female manager or leader that would bend the rules to do the right thing for someone else at their own expense? Or will they only do what's in their interest while claiming the victim role for themselves the entire time? Let me know in the comments section what you think. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time.